So good morning or good afternoon. We would like to welcome you again to Norwich University's 2020 Military Writers Symposium. If you are joining us for the first session, welcome back. And if you're joining us for the very first time, welcome. We are absolutely pleased and honored that you're able to join us from different parts of the globe for this very important topic and for our 26th Military Writer Symposium. My name is Dr. Travis Morris. I happen to be the director for the Military Writers Symposium and the Patton Peace and War Center. This is a joint initiative between the Center for Global Resilience and Security and the Peace and War Center. And for all of you that are joining us, we're thrilled that you're here. Our only regret is that you're not able to join us during the beautiful fall foliage here in our amazing state of Vermont. For those of you that were not with us the first session, I would like to recommend that you view the President Anarumo's welcome. This is on the Military Writers Symposium's website. And if you look in the chat feature, there will be a link. Please watch his introduction as it provides just an overview and context for our symposium today and the important history that's associated with this event. We have an absolutely engaging lineup for you, starting from our first session with Dr. Nadir Al-Ansari to the current session from Dr. David O'Connor. Today we're examining weaponizing water, ancient tactic, modern implication, and we have some of the globe's leading thinkers and scholars today. We would also just like to mention this is our inaugural year, not only going virtual, but to offer a micro certificate through the Arctic Circle's Cold War on Norwich Pro. Please check this out on the Military Writers Symposium's website. And again, this is free. And if you're interested in engaging this topic even further, you'll be able to get a micro certificate in that topic. If you're not a member of the Military Writers Symposium's associate, then consider being one. There are no fees to belong to the associates, just an expectation that you help to partner with us and to grow our beloved symposium to higher horizons. And the newsletter is on our website as well. We are absolutely honored today to have Dr. David Kilcullen with us. Personally, I have followed his line of thinking through his publications over the years, and I've spoken with numerous alumni and other colleagues in different defense agencies around the globe that have done the same. And we're absolutely honored and thrilled, Dave, to have you with us. Dr. Kilcullen has an incredible background, and to introduce him, we're going to have our highest ranking cadet, our cadet colonel, Caleb Miller, who is a CJ major, who will introduce Dr. Dave Kilcullen. So Dr. Kilcullen, welcome to Vermont and welcome to the 2020 Norwich Military Writers Symposium.
Thank you.
Good morning and good afternoon. Dr. David Kilcullen is founder and chairman of Caris Global Solutions, a strategic research and design firm that helps governments, global institutions, businesses, and communities build resiliency in conflict, disaster-affected, and post-conflict environments. Before joining private industry, Dr. Kilcullen served 24 years as an Army officer, diplomat, and policy advisor for the Australian and United States governments. After serving in command in operational missions, including peacekeeping, counterinsurgency, and foreign internal defense across the Middle East, Southeast Asia, and Europe, he retired as a Lieutenant Colonel of Light Infantry, then served as a senior analyst in the Office of National Assessments, focused on Southeast Asian terrorism, and was a member of the writing team for Australia's National Counterterrorism Strategy. In the United States, he served on the writing team for the 2006 Quadrennial Defense Review, then a chief strategist in the State Department's Counterterrorism Bureau, where he served, designed the Regional Security Initiative, and served in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, Southeast Asia, and the Horn of Africa. He served in Iraq as a member of the Joint Strategic Assessment Team and as Senior Counterinsurgency Advisor to Multinational Force Iraq through 2007. Before becoming Special Advisor for Counterinsurgency to the Secretary of State in 2008 and 2009. He was the State Department's representative on the 2008 Loot Review of Afghanistan-Pakistan Strategy, was lead author for the U.S. Government Counterinsurgency Handbook, and founded the ISAF Counterinsurgency Advisory Assistance Team in 2009. Dr. Kilcullen was named one of the foreign policy top 100 global thinkers in 2009. His best-selling books, The Accidental Guerrilla and Counterinsurgency, are used in universities and by policymakers, the military, and development agencies worldwide. His third book, Out of the Mountains, which examines conflict in the connected coastal cities of the future, was awarded the 2013 America Publishers Association Prize for Professional and Scholarly Excellence in Government and Politics. In 2016, Oxford University Press will publish his fourth book, Blood Year. Sir, welcome, and thank you for being here.
Caleb, thank you, and it's a great honor to be part of this Military Writers Symposium. So I will get right into my presentation, and I'll look forward to hearing people's comments and fielding questions once we're done. So thanks.
Yes, sir.
Let me share my slides with you guys. There is a delay on the slide, so I'm going to try to remember that as we go. So what I want to talk about today is COVID, conflict, and water. And I want to look back a decade at some lessons from the Arab Spring and think about how they might be relevant to what we're dealing with now. I took this photograph in November of 2018 on the outskirts of the city of Hargeisa in Somaliland. Somaliland is an unrecognized breakaway province of the country of Somalia. It also happens to be extremely well-governed, liberal, democratic, and relatively peaceful as far as the Horn of Africa is concerned. This particular photograph shows women and children from a community of rural herders from the desert area in the middle of Somaliland who have come into the outskirts of Hargeisa. They're now living in a shanty town that doesn't have electricity or water, and there is a set number of faucets that they can access to get water for their community. One of the things that you find when you work in Africa and in the Middle East is that population movement, economics, urbanization, and conflict are very closely intertwined. The number of herders and families that come into the city every year depends heavily on drought conditions, which leads to crop conditions for camels, which is the main livestock that these guys run. The other key factor is conflict. If there's major violence going on outside the city, you get more people coming in. You even get a situation where people will go outside the city during the day but come in by night because of conflict. And so what you see is a sort of knock-on effect from conflict and crisis in rural environments to the degree of demand that's put on urban systems. And it turns out that when you take this kind of set of ideas and apply it to cities across the Middle East and Africa, but in some ways also Latin America and elsewhere, there's a very close relationship between water, conflict, the status of cities, and the development of economies. Let me give you an example from the period of the Arab Spring. So you can see on this map in the bottom a timeline from the year 2000 to 2008, looking at grain prices in brown, and wheat in particular in red. And you'll see that very significant spike in the price of wheat into 2007 and 2008. I'm going to explain what drove that in a minute. But the important thing to realize here is that, as you'll see with the sort of black fist and the no entry signs across the map, one of the things that happened as a result of this massive spike in grain prices was very significant protests and unrest across Latin America, Africa, and to a lesser extent, the Middle East. but also in Southeast Asia and India, we saw food crises. Now, those of you that have done survival training will know about the rule of threes, right? You can survive 3 minutes without air, 3 hours without shelter, 3 days without water, and 3 weeks without food. That's true if you don't live in the Middle East. I would argue that in the Middle East, you can survive about 3 hours without water under certain circumstances. And one of the things we see is that a food crisis will translate into unrest over a matter of weeks. A water crisis is an immediate crisis, and it leads to pretty rapid, like within a day, unrest. So, you know, if you live in the Middle East and you don't have electricity, it's unpleasant, and people will die, but it's not going to generate a major crisis. If you have a food shortage, people will immediately move to where the food is, and within a few weeks, you're going to have some kind of crisis. But if you have a water crisis, they will almost immediately engage in unrest or riots because it's an immediate lethal threat to them and their families. Looking at world food prices from 2008 through to 2012, so that's the period of the global financial crisis and then the Arab Spring, the red line shows you the world food price index on a base of 2004. So already at the beginning of 2008, world food prices were twice what they were in 2004. And you can then track how they changed over time between the collapse of Lehman Brothers and the fall of the global economic environment into a financial crisis in 2008, through a short period of stabilization, and then the beginning of the Arab Spring starting in about September of 2010, but really spiking in December of 2010 and then spreading across the Arab world through 2011. Let me point out the role of water here, particularly in that second phase leading into the Arab Spring. So already prices are fairly high in September and October of 2010. And you'll note at the bottom here, you'll see that red box that just appeared. Between June and September of 2010, we had the deepest Russian drought in a generation. And there was also a whole series of wildfires associated with that lack of water in Russia. Russia is a key element in the world's grain supply, and it basically knocked out approximately one third of Russia's grain crop in that summer into fall period of 2010. The next one to note, unlike a drought, was the sort of too much water problem in Pakistan, where flooding in the period of August to October of 2010 destroyed a million tons of grain reserves in Pakistan. And in the following month, heavy rains in Australia destroyed a large amount of the crop yield for Australia. So you have Russia, Pakistan, and Australia all experiencing problems of too much or too little water in that summer into fall of 2010. And you can immediately see the massive impact on food prices as a result of that grain shortage caused by a water shortage, leading right into the beginning of the Arab Spring. So we often think about the Arab Spring in geopolitical or ideological or security terms, almost as if it was just some kind of ass-kicking that fell out of a clear blue sky with no warning. It wasn't. It was a direct result of the global financial crisis, the collapse of world food markets, the rains and flooding in various grain-producing countries, and then the impact of that on people's livelihood, leading to the unrest that drove the Arab Spring. So, again, the drought, food and water insecurity that led to protests like this one in Cairo, Egypt, rapidly spread across the Middle East. In the case of Libya, one of the issues for Libya was access to underground water. So you can see in the green, blue, and brown lines here on this map of Libya was known as the Great Man-Made River, which was probably the most important water project in the history of Libya. It had a lot of international support. It involved tapping into underground aquifers under the Nubian sandstone structure in the southern part of Libya, and then building tunnel systems and pumping houses and a series of reservoirs to bring water from the unoccupied or uninhabited desert of southern Libya to the very heavily populated coastal strip. Libya had one of the fastest growing rates of urbanization anywhere in the Mediterranean basin between 1970 and 2010. And in large measure, that was a result of the successful bringing of water to the urban environments on the coastlines of Libya. And one of the related problems was that Libya traditionally was not one country, but actually three. Cyrenaica in the east with its headquarters or its capital in Benghazi. Then across the Gulf of Sidra to the west, Tripolitania, which had its capital in Tripoli. And then to the south, the Fezzan region, which is populated by different ethnic groups and tied more into the interior of the Sahara rather than into the Mediterranean environment as the other two regions were. Now, Fezzan, Cyrenaica, and Tripolitania were different colonies under Italy. They were united by the United Nations after the end of the Italian period, and then taken over by Muammar Gaddafi, the dictator of Libya in the 1960s. And by far the most dominant region in Libya under Gaddafi was Tripolitania. There was a lot of angst and a sense of grievance and injustice by people living in the east of the country about what was happening to water supply and what the fact that the eastern part of the country was taking a lot more of the water than they would consider that it deserved based on where that water was coming from. That turned out to be a key element in the outbreak of fighting in 2011, which rapidly became urban, coastal, irregular warfare, in part for control of the cities, but also very much for control of the water supply to those cities. And as that conflict in Libya has dragged on now for almost a decade, control over the Great Man-Made River, over the reservoirs, over access to water supplies has become a critical weaponization of the terrain, the hydrography of Libya, by both the current government and the government of General Haftar in the eastern part. Of the country. So here we see an example where the Arab Spring crisis, which was, as we've seen, was quite heavily driven by water in the first place, translated into a civil war in Libya, the first civil war of the Arab Spring, and then has been perpetuated in large part by people weaponizing access to underground water and surface rainfall for cities in the country of Libya. The other country that was very heavily affected by water shortages during this period was Syria. Syria had already experienced very severe drought from 2008 onward. And this map produced by the World Food Program in the middle of 2009 shows the regions, Hasaka in the east, the Raqqa region in the north, and the Homs, and particularly the interior of Homs and Deir ez-Zor in the south and east of the country, being very, very heavily affected by shortfalls in rainfall and by drought during the period of immediately preceding the Arab Spring. The other big problem for Syria in this period was that a large number, between 3 and 4.5 million refugees from Iraq had already moved into Syria from Iraq. And like the first picture I showed you from Hargeisa, these individuals ended up settling in informal settlements on the outskirts of Syrian cities that didn't have access to electricity or water or a lot of other services, and putting additional strain on cities that were already struggling to service their urban population. In the 6 months prior to the outbreak of the Arab Spring, in addition to the food shortage, which we've already talked about, there was a really significant drought, in even worse than what I'm showing you here, in Syria. And that led to a very large number of members of the rural farming population moving to the cities in search of water. And the outbreak of conflict in Syria, which happened in the town of Daraa in central Syria, was in fact triggered by protests over lack of access to water as the city infrastructure became progressively unable to cope with the city's population, the influx of refugees, and then the move of displaced people from Syrian rural areas into the city. And it was riots over water and the beating and arrest of several children who were involved in those riots that led to mass demonstrations and became the trigger for the Arab Spring in Syria. And that was why it became a critical area for conflict among the different combatants in the Syrian war. Likewise, in Iraq, when Islamic State captured the city of Mosul, Iraq's second city in the northern part of Iraq, control over the Mosul Dam, which provides the majority of water for the city of Mosul, was one of the very first flashpoints in the combat between Islamic State, the Kurds, and the Iraqi government. So you can see here a Kurdish soldier moving along the edge of the Mosul Dam during the battle for the Mosul Dam, which happened in August of 2014, and rapidly resulted in the capture of the Mosul Dam by both Kurdish and Iraqi forces. That cut off access to hydroelectric power and also access to water to large parts of the city of Mosul. And one of the biggest problems for the Islamic State during the period of 2014 to 2016, when they occupied Mosul, was lack of access to water. So electricity and clean drinking water became in very short supply in a pretty rapid timeframe while the city was under ISIS control. At one point in 2015 and 2016, there were less than 2 hours a day of electricity. And in Iraq, the water supply is, because it's a fairly flat country, is largely run by electrical pumps. So when the electricity goes out, the water goes out. So people were drinking unclean water from the river that flows through the center of the city. They weren't having access to pumped water. They weren't getting access to sanitization of water through the water sterilization plants that exist in the city. And this became a major source of unrest for ISIS as it sought to control the city. Now, we often talk about the ethics and the politics around weaponization of water. And it's worth noting that in Western military practice, we do not normally regard it as legitimate to cut off the water supply to a civilian population. But actors like the Iraqi government, the Syrian government, the non-state actors who are fighting them, regard that as a fairly normal approach to warfare. That's also true in the conflict in Yemen. Both the Houthis, who control the city of Sana'a, and in this case, the city of Al-Hudaydah, which is a coastal city in Yemen, and the Saudi-led coalition that is fighting against them, have targeted water supplies as a way of gaining control over cities and, again, over populations, much as we saw in Syria, Iraq, and Libya in the examples I've already given. That led to a very major humanitarian crisis last year in the city of Hudaydah, and there have been calls by the international community for combatants to not seek to control or dominate water as part of a sort of weaponization of that. I think the chances of that being successful are very slim, precisely because of what we've already been talking about, that in fact it is an extremely good way, in a military sense, of controlling terrain to control access to water. So I think we can expect that in internal conflicts and in intrastate conflicts in the foreseeable future, people are going to continue to weaponize water. One to watch as we're looking into the future is the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam, which is currently being built by the Ethiopian government on the Blue Nile, which as it flows downstream has a major impact on Egypt and on the access to water that's needed for growth of food in the Nile Delta in northern Egypt. This dam project has already led to at least two war scares between Ethiopia and Egypt. And there are very strident calls from Egypt to cease construction of this dam, with the threat that if the dam does go through and blocks the supply of water to Egypt, that that would be a casus belli for war between Egypt and Ethiopia. So we've talked a lot in the international literature about water wars, and in recent experience, that's mostly been to do with intrastate conflicts, as we've been talking about in the Arab Spring. But the idea of an interstate water war is certainly not at all far-fetched. And if we're looking for potential flashpoints, the Blue Nile and the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam is top of my list as a potential flashpoint to think about. As we go into the COVID pandemic at the beginning of 2020, we're also already dealing with a major locust plague in the Horn of Africa, including the area of Hargeisa, which I showed you in my first photograph, and also food insecurity across very large parts of the Horn of Africa and the southern part of the Arabian Peninsula. And again, food insecurity in this case, very heavily driven by drought and minimal water supply to service crops. So that was the going in position before the beginning of the pandemic, where we had pretty widespread African and Middle Eastern food insecurity risks in 2020 that were dramatically exacerbated by the collapse of international trade and the lockdowns and the changes in the international economic environment as a result of the pandemic. It's worth thinking about the pandemic now, not just as a public health crisis, as a virus that's causing illness, but more as a complex emergency, or in this case, a multi-phase complex emergency. So a complex emergency in the international literature is a situation where you have threats to livelihoods or to the survival of a population, and dealing with those threats is then complicated by economic and conflict issues. And if we think about the period from the second quarter of 2020 onward, we see a number of waves, right? Initially, a very severe public health crisis in early 2020. We're now seeing a second wave in many parts of the world that we're interested in. For each of these waves, you get kind of an onset, a peak impact, a brief recovery phase, you then get a certain number of recurrences and then a reset. Immediately following that public health crisis, we got the second wave of economic impact. That was particularly severe in the first half of 2020 into the summer, and is now seeming to be resolving in some countries, with the possibility of recurrence over the winter and into spring of next year. The third phase is the security crisis, which starts as a human security crisis, and we've already talked about food and water. It rapidly translates into an internal security or an internal unrest crisis. So we've seen that in Latin America. We've seen it in the US, of course. We've seen it in some countries in Europe. We're also currently seeing it in the Middle East and North Africa. And then that internal security crisis can translate into international security problems, where nation states seek to direct the anger and the grievances of their internal population towards an external scapegoat. It might be Greece and Turkey. It might be Azerbaijan and Armenia. It might be Venezuela and Colombia, Syria and Turkey, Turkey and Iraq, a whole series of potential crises that have developed over the last 6 months. In one way, they are to do with geopolitics and the existing tensions between countries. But in another, it's an artifact of the pandemic, the economic impact of that, the security crisis, and the need for governments to divert attention elsewhere rather than face up to the internal criticisms of their own population. It's also worth pointing out that the peak compound impact of public health, economic, and security factors is about to hit us around November of this year. And that also happens to be when we're going to see the most violently contested US presidential election in living memory in about 3.5 weeks from now. So on that very cheery note, let me stop sharing my slides and we'll go to Q&A and discuss whatever you guys want to talk about.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Kilcullen, for a lot of information that is forming some questions and just some of the most contentious subjects on our globe today. I just want to remind all of our participants, should you have a question for Dr. Kilcullen, please go to the question section of our webinar and just type your question there. So Dr. Kilcullen, the first question has to do with Libya and hydrology. And the question is that after a decade of conflict of war, was hydrology part of the NATO planning process at the beginning? And if not, how have you seen it evolve today in understanding conflict, specifically kinetic conflict with nations?
So yes and no. So European companies had actually been very heavily involved in the construction, and American companies too, of the Great Man-Made River. And people were well aware of water as kind of an input to the IPB, right? The Intelligence Preparation of the Battlefield for Unified Protector, which was the NATO operation in Libya in 2011. But it wasn't seen as a dynamic factor. It was kind of seen as a background static element to consider, you know, like the terrain. Pretty rapidly as the conflict developed, control over two key liquids, right, turned out to be important, water and oil. Oil got most of the attention in the first year, control for the oil fields and of the refineries and access to distribution of oil was a key part of the conflict in 2011. But as time has gone on, and General Khalifa Haftar from the eastern part, from the Cyrenaica region of Benghazi, fighting against the National Unity Government in Tripoli, control over water has been a key element of the maneuver for both sides. Now, currently, international institutions are supporting the government in Tripoli, but a very important group of international players, including the UAE and Turkey and Russia and others, are supporting the government in the east, the Hiftar provisional government in the east. So they've got two different entities supported by different organizations and countries around the world, and conflict over resources that are, I think you saw on the map, there's a narrow line that goes close to the coast in Libya, and that's where there's enough rainfall to sustain life, and it's a tiny percentage, maybe 10% of the country. The rest of the country's water needs draw very heavily on that fossil water in the southern part of the country. One that's getting a lot of attention is this conflict in the north. One area that I think is worth tracking as well as we think about the hydrology is the fact that most of this water comes from wells that sit under Fezzan in the south. And that population has been very vulnerable to being targeted by jihadist groups. So ISIS in the greater Sahel, Al-Qaeda, groups from the Maghreb in the western part of the Sahara, and from further south toward Mali, have all been reaching into Fezzan, and people from Fezzan have been reaching out as well to say, you guys are kind of shackled to the corpse of a non-functional regime in the northern part of the country. You actually own the water resources, and you're getting no credit and no political support as a result of that. Why don't you come with us? So I think the idea of water as a possible trigger for separatism is not unique to Libya, but it's definitely a factor to consider as that conflict develops going forward in Libya as well.
Excellent, thank you. So we're going to move from Libya over to Asia, and I'm going to combine a couple of questions here. So one questioner is asking, during World War II, China, in their war with Japan, broke flood levees to slow Japanese advances. Another question asks about China building dams, which could serve as a flashpoint with Indochina countries like Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. Could you just discuss your perspectives on these strategies and tactics and how you see them being potentially implemented?
So the control over levees, and I'm also going to talk about sluice gates in a minute, is a really traditional tactic. And yes, in China, also traditionally in Europe. So in Belgium and the Netherlands, one of the reactions to German invasion in World War II, and in the case of Belgium in World War I as well, was to break levees or to open floodgates in order to flood very large parts of Belgium and the Netherlands and the Low Countries. And that actually, of course, channels the maneuver of an attacking adversary into certain areas. What's known as polder land in the Low Country is area that's reclaimed from the sea. And that had a very significant role to play in 1944 in the Battle of Arnhem in the Netherlands, and also around Antwerp in Belgium in World War I. So this is very much a feature of Chinese traditional approach to warfare, but also we saw it in Korea, and as I said, in Europe. One thing to note, of course, is that, yes, you can flood, you can break levees and flood an area with seawater. You are then destroying cropland for potentially generations. And one of the big, because you're bringing salt water into crop areas, one of the big impacts in the Netherlands in the 1950s and on into the 1960s, actually, was reclaiming land that had been flooded during World War II, and then that had a very significant negative effect on the ability to grow crops in those areas after the war. In terms of the Mekong River, which is the river that connects those countries in Asia that we've been talking about, that is another very key potential area for an interstate water war. There's a management regime looking at how to control the water from the Mekong. The Salween and Sitang rivers in Myanmar also are subject to dispute with the countries around Myanmar. And there's, so I would say, obviously the Jordan River in the Middle East, the Nile, the Mekong, and in some ways the Amazon are actually potential, you know, regional resources that countries are potentially likely to fight over in a potential future conflict. And I think that's an area where, as we think about the geostrategy of Asia, the rise of China, the competition between China and India for regional dominance in the Indo-PACOM, AOR, and then how the US and US allies react to that, riverine operations and thinking about how control of rivers as well as sea space affects politics, that's a key element as we think about how to plan for future conflict.
Once again, thank you for a very detailed analysis of those potential threats and what's going on currently and what potentially could happen. So we've spent some time in your presentation and also in some of your responses diagnosing the issue of weaponizing water. This next question has to do more with prognostics or solutions here. So could you provide us with some thoughts about maybe moving ahead and addressing some of these concerns with weaponizing water that you've addressed? And that's an open-ended question, so you can take that either at the tactical, the micro level, or either at the macro strategic level.
So let me talk, I mentioned sluice gates in my last answer. Let me just pick that up. The Tamil Tigers, who were crushed in Sri Lanka in 2009, if you trace back to that in that final campaign that destroyed the Tamil Tigers, you see at the beginning of that campaign a very serious error on the part of the Tamil Tiger leadership, which was to seize and turn off the Mavil Aru sluice gate, which was a sluice gate. So a sluice gate's like a trapdoor that controls the access of irrigation water to a given area from a river. They took over the Mavil Aru sluice gate area and turned off the water supply to about 20% of Sri Lanka's farming land in 2006. And that immediately led to a food and water crisis for a very large part of the rural population in eastern Sri Lanka. That turned that population against the Tamil Tigers toward the government. It gave the government a key grievance that it was able to exploit in that final campaign. And the government then had enough popular support to go ahead and actually mount a particularly brutal but very effective campaign to destroy the Tamil Tigers. So you could argue that after 30 years of being one of the world's most successful terrorist and insurgent organizations, the Tamil Tigers shot themselves in the foot by targeting and trying to control that water supply around the Mavil Aru sluice gate. So at the tactical level, I think we can expect people to continue weaponizing water just because it's so effective, as we've talked about, as a way of controlling populations and cities. But it can be an own goal. It can be something that actually turns a population against you very rapidly. So thinking about, at the tactical level, how to exploit an enemy's weaponization of water is something that we might want to factor in to the way we plan operations. In Afghanistan, for example, we did that a lot. Control over water was one of the things that the Taliban did as a way of achieving a chokehold over the population. Different operations in big, large operations in Afghanistan, one of the key elements was thinking about regaining control of water, in some cases purifying water that had been poisoned, and then getting that water to populations and farmers and cities very quickly as a way of cementing our relationship with the population in Afghanistan who'd been targeted by the Taliban. We saw similar things in Syria, where the government and the Islamic State were controlling water, in some cases selling water to cities. So at one point in the war in Syria, the Islamic State controlled a lot of the water for the central breadbasket area of Syria, and were actually selling that water at a hefty markup to cities and to the Syrian government, their nominal enemy, as a way of generating revenue. And then finally, at the big geopolitical and sort of regulatory level, I do think that there's been a movement for a generation in the international legal and human rights community to talk about making weaponization of water illicit and a war crime, and to have a protocol or a set of agreements around how water is treated as part of a campaign. That is well developed in the legal and sort of moral consciousness literature of people that think about this. But I do feel that the idea that combatants are going to stop weaponizing water is pretty far-fetched for many of these areas, principally because it's just such a powerful tool that's there in the arsenal of a combatant for gaining control over a population or over a region rapidly. So I think we can expect to see hydrology generally, but just the intelligence preparation of the battlefield being very closely linked in many parts of the world to control over water. And we ignore that at our peril as we think about how to plan for those kinds of operations.
So thank you very much. In fact, the next set of questions I'm combining two, but it's actually continuing the discussion, Dr. Kilcullen, just taking it down maybe a more nuanced pathway. So two questions ask, do you think that the UN Security Council, or as you interact with different military security planners and strategic thinkers across the globe, do you think they are preemptively considering the nexus between water and security in their planning in pre and post operations? And then if so, could you highlight a couple of entities, whether they be the UN Security Council, NATO, or some military or nation that you believe is leading the charge in this way of thinking about weaponizing water and hydrology?
So absolutely, people are thinking about this. The UN has a whole section, the Food and Agriculture Organization and the World Food Program think very heavily about water. And of course, drought relief and the nexus between drought and conflict has been pretty heavily addressed by both the UN and the World Bank in recent years. If you take a look at the World Development Report for 2011, which is produced by the World Bank, or there's more recently a document called Pathways to Peace that was produced jointly by the UN and the World Bank. There's a fair bit in there about food and water and its relationship with conflict. In terms of military organizations, I would point people to the resilience agenda that NATO has put in place over the last couple of years. Everyone's familiar with NATO Article 5, which calls on countries to support each other in the event that any one nation is attacked by an external threat. But there's also Article 3, which requires nations to be resilient, to work on their own kind of self-help and resistance to challenges. And that's become a key element of the NATO agenda in the last 3 years or so. NATO has what it calls 7 baseline requirements: water and access to reliable and pure, like purified water is a key baseline requirement. And NATO has commissioned a number of studies, but it's also focusing on commitments by nations to guarantee their resilience in the event of water. I would point to the fact that modern water systems are controlled by SCADA controllers, in other words, little microprocessor computers, many of which are connected to the internet. And that's true not only in developed countries, but also in less developed regions of the world. And as I mentioned in the Iraqi example, that may be to do with water supply, it might be to do with purification of water, but it may also often be to do with hydroelectric power or the use of electricity grid. We have a very significant attack surface for a cyber threat or an adversary cyber actor targeting water supply systems that are run by microcomputers and connected to the internet. And that's a proliferating challenge, which NATO is addressing as part of its baseline examination of cybersecurity and the so-called Internet of Things and how that intersects with water. So yeah, I would look World Bank, UN, and all the NATO resiliency stuff, all of which is available open source on the internet, to think about how that might relate to ways to think about the best practice for future planning.
Thank you very much. So we're going to go back to one of your slides in which you addressed at the beginning of your presentation, or a couple of your slides, and back to Libya. So the questioner is asking, how do you differentiate water as a cause of rebellion versus water as a tactical strategic target of a politically driven movement? So in other words, for example, did the Libyan guerrillas fight for political goals and then fight for water resources for survival, or was it the other way around? Would you be able to share your thoughts on that, please?
So water plays a role at every stage, but it is a different role. So before the outbreak of the conflict in Libya, one of the key grievances was this belief that I mentioned earlier, that the Tripolitania region, and in particular the area around the capital city of Tripoli, where Muammar Gaddafi originated from — he originated from a town called Sirte, but his base was in Tripoli — the belief that that region was taking more than its fair share of resources. So that applied to money, it applied to oil, but it particularly applied to water. And for long periods before the conflict broke out, if you lived in Benghazi, you had very limited access to sanitation. You didn't get clean water. The water system broke down very frequently. And yet at the same time, you were well aware that a lot of the water that was going to Tripoli and a lot of the money that was feeding the infrastructure budget in Tripoli came from Benghazi, which is where a majority of the oil was located. So there was this grievance that water played a role in the causes of the war because it fed into the grievance. Then when the war actually broke out, control over cities was the key, because that's where the population is in Libya. And people realized pretty quickly, okay, I can fight house to house, Stalingrad style, and lose thousands of guys and take weeks to capture the city, or I can cut off the water sewage treatment plant and the water supply through the pumping station, which typically is on the outskirts of the city and less well defended. It might take me a company to seize that and then a battalion to coordinate. I can get it done in a day and then the city's going to fall. So traditional 18th century siege warfare, where you dig your big trench around the city and you gradually advance your gun positions and eventually the city falls, that may not at all be necessary if you're talking about a desert city that relies on water supply from a small number of areas. So you may just want to seize those and hold them. In the battle for Aleppo in Syria, battle for the water supply, which is all on the outskirts of the city, that was the heaviest fighting until the battle got into the downtown part of Aleppo, and it was all about control over those external facilities, where if you can control that, the city's just going to wither on the vine, right? So in terms of operational planning, that was important. And then tactically, the fighting very much centered on critical infrastructure and in many cases, water. And then finally, water plays a really important role in reconstruction. If you want displaced people to return to a given town, and you want to put the economy back on its feet and recreate food supplies and essential services, recreating water supply that may have been disrupted or destroyed as part of the fighting becomes a key element in your reconstruction. So I would sort of say that water's like this kind of blue ribbon that flows all the way through from pre-war to the actual fighting, to the reconstruction, to then the peace deal afterward and control over water and what happens to it. And it also affects how we think about regulation and ethics and morals and the laws of armed conflict. So you could argue that if you just dig 6 inches below the surface of any conflict, you're going to find water seeping into that hole pretty quickly as a key element in the way that we may think about conflict at every level.
It's a fantastic metaphor. So we're going to take us to another direction, and we're going to go back again to one of your slides. And this is just maybe a different take on the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. So the questioner asks, do you have any theories or thoughts on China's goal of investing over $1 billion in the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. What is the Chinese strategy? What's their payoff? What's their interest in that particular water work? And we have about 5 minutes left in the session, Dr. Kilcullen.
Thanks. So very quickly, we have to see the Chinese investment in the context of the much broader Belt and Road Initiative, which of course is a key part of China's push for global economic, industrial, and ultimately military influence. In the case of Africa, Ethiopia is one of the most heavily targeted areas for Chinese investment. And you walk around Addis Ababa, the capital of Ethiopia, and you'll see very large numbers of construction projects ongoing. The vast majority of those are funded or even being performed by Chinese companies, in many cases, state-owned enterprises. Chinese business people often like to say, well, I'm a private company, I have nothing to do with the government. But we're talking about a communist country here, right? So the difference between a government-owned enterprise and a private enterprise in China is one phone call. And we've seen many examples of that in recent times. In the case of the Greater Ethiopian Renaissance Dam, part of that Chinese investment in Ethiopia has gone to that project. We see similar Chinese investments in Sudan, in Afghanistan, in Kenya, many other parts of the developing world, also in Venezuela and in Panama. So there's a general global strategy by the Chinese of inserting themselves into large infrastructure projects. And as we've already said, water is so central to conflict that those large infrastructure projects in many cases will involve water. But of course, that's not the only element that the Chinese are investing in. So I think it's really a case of inserting themselves into the global infrastructure ecosystem and water being a really important part of that. So I suspect that as this global geopolitical and geoeconomic competition between the US and China plays out in the next generation, water access, water infrastructure, and the construction of large-scale projects like the dam will be a key part of it. I'll end with just one brief observation. The only part of Africa that I've ever been in where I've not seen any Chinese investment was Hargeisa and the breakaway province of Somaliland. And there's a key reason for that, which is for China to recognize Somaliland and recognize that breakaway region would have significant implications for places like Tibet, Hong Kong, Macau, and Taiwan. And the Chinese have a really strong geopolitical reason for not wanting to give credence to those separatist or nationalist aspirations in those regions of China. And as a result, they've been very restrained in what they've been able to do in the Somaliland area. And I think it's worth pointing out that, again, geopolitics, water, and conflict sort of intertwine through all these areas that we've been talking about over the last hour or so.
Dr. Kilcullen, an absolute robust thank you. You have given us a lot to think about. And I'm just thinking of our attendees that are joining us from all over the world that are different parts of different militaries, but also I'm thinking of our own student body that's going to graduate and inherit and engage and think through some of the things that you have addressed over the course of your presentation and also spend time in that part of the world. So your presentation today and the US answering questions has given us the opportunity to be proactive in our thinking and strategically align with others that put environmental security on the front and center of their radars and for us to engage in that as an undergraduate institution, but also for those that are actively deployed in this very work right now. So would also like to mention for the rest of those joining us, if you are interested in receiving a signed copy of one of Dr. Kilcullen's books, you'll be able to go to our website tomorrow after our panel. You'll be able to request a signed copy and we'll make sure we get that copy available to you. So we wish you well, Dr. Kilcullen, and your future endeavors. Thank you so much for joining us today. And like we've said to the previous presenter, our Our regret is that we can't have you here in our beautiful campus and our beautiful state this time of year, but please just consider this a rain check for a future opportunity. And we certainly do appreciate the time and just your thoughts that you've sent our way. So thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much. It's a real pleasure to be here. And I hope that you guys enjoyed it as much as I did.
We certainly have. And so for everyone else that's on the call, our next session is a special one. We're going to be awarding the Kobe Military Writers Award to Adam Higginbotham. Like I mentioned earlier, we have created a film for you to watch for the context and background of that award. Please watch that before our next session here at noon. So enjoy this break. We'll see you back here in a few moments, and we'll hear another presentation on Chernobyl and this year's Kobe Award recipient. Dr. Kilcullen, all the best, and thank you once again, sir.
Thank you. Thanks again for having me.
Cheers.